Hi students, welcome to today's video. Today we are going to discuss these topics. We will start with variations in the for loop, then we will start discussing while loop. Okay, so we can discuss variations in the for loop first. So students, here you can see a simple for loop. So this for loop will iterate 5 times and welcome will print 5 times. We can see. Okay, so this is the program. See, this one is printing welcome 5 times. Okay, so this is the normal working of a for loop, or we can say this is the normal for loop. Okay, the first variation we can say, see here, the which type of control variable we are using here, integer type, isn't it? So this we can declare as double also. Okay, so compilation has done, no problem with the compilation. Okay, then see, after changing the data type to double, then also this one is printing welcome 5 time, the same output. What it means, we can use double type data type, double type variable also, isn't it? Not only double type, we can use character type also. Character I is equal to what we can say, let it be A. Okay, then we can write here I is equal to less than or equal to f. Okay, then f I plus plus. Okay, then also it is shown no syntax error message. We can check how many times it will execute. See, 6 times that we given. So 6 times this one is executing. So we can understand any type of variable we can use as control variable. Okay, so then next we are going to use boolean type variable. Okay, so students, see, you can see this program is using a boolean variable. Okay, so this program will execute how many times? Definitely 5 times. When the value of I reaches to 5, it will print welcome. With that, it will also change the value of the variable B. Okay, so here control variable I is used. Okay, so just we can change the control variable. Okay, so here we are going to use a boolean variable B. See, here you can see we are declaring a boolean variable B with the value false. Okay, so we can write the condition when B not equal to true. Okay, when B not equal to true, this will execute. See, actual value of B is false. So what about this condition B not equal to true? So the condition, the actual condition will be false not equal to true. Okay, so this condition will be like this: false not equal to true, value of B is false. So this condition is true, isn't it? Okay, so this condition becomes true and it will print SOP 1, because value of I is 1 and 1 modulus 5 will be a non-zero value, isn't it? So this condition becomes false. So when the value of I reaches 1, this condition becomes false, isn't it? So we can write, when the value of I become 1, this condition becomes false. Okay, then when the value of I reaches, so when this condition becomes false, these two statements will not execute, isn't it? So going to the test update statement, incrementing value of I as 2. Okay, then checking the condition B not equal to true. So value of B still false, so this condition becomes true. So it will iterate second time, printing value of I now. Okay, so now it will print 2. Then checking 2 modulus 5 0 or not. 2 modulus 5 is not equal to 0, because we are taking the remainder. This 0 will be remainder. This modulo operator will give the remainder, not the quotient. So quotient will not be 0, so this condition becomes false again. Okay, then so if this condition is true, body of the if will not execute, go into I++, value of I will be 3. okay, then checking condition, condition is same true, okay. So again iterating third time. So 3 modulus 5 will be checked. 3 modulus 5 is a non-zero value, so this condition again false. So skipping these statements again, then incrementing value of I, which is 4, okay. Okay, then after incrementing value of I, it is checking the condition B not equal to true, that is true already, also that is true. So then again executing, value of I will be printed, which is 4 already printed. Then checking condition 4 modulus 5 equal to 0, this is a non-zero value, isn't it? So condition becomes false. So when this condition is false, this will be skipped again, go into I++, value of I will be 5, as you know. So checking condition B not equal to true, so condition is true, okay. Then we can execute body printing value of I, which is 5, okay. Then checking condition 5 modulus 5 equal to 0, at that time what will happen? The condition will be like this, 5 modulus 5 equal to 0. This condition becomes true because when we divide 5 with 5, 5 into 1 will be 5, so remainder is 0. So result of this expression is 0, that is matching with 0, so the true. When this condition is true, now we can execute these two. We are changing value of B to true, earlier it was false, now that is true, okay. Then printing welcome, it will print welcome with this output, okay. Then statements over, go into I++ again, value of I will become 6. Then condition is B not equal to true. Now what is the condition? B not equal to true, the same condition, but the change is value of B is true now, true not equal to true. So this condition becomes false because true equal to true, not actually true equal to true. So this condition becomes, this condition is false. So loop will not iterate coming out of the loop. So what we got as the output? See, this one will be the output. So here what I mean is, here we can use a Boolean type of variable as the control variable of the for loop. Okay. Then we are going to learn about infinite loop. Infinite loop means its number of iteration gonna be infinite. Any number of time it may iterate. So we can check how it will work. Okay, you can see what it will print. So we can remove this boolean also. Okay. So students, see, just a for loop, then the body of the for loop is a print function. Okay, so it will print welcome. So we haven't written any initialization here. This part will have initialization, in the middle it will have test condition, then after at the right side it will have test update statement. So without all this, we are going to execute this program. So compiled, no syntax error we got, so we can execute. So going to execute, see, this program is not ending. Here you can see, if you notice here, this program is going infinite. Okay, so we can stop this program. So this program is known as, still it is executing, okay, see. So this program is known as infinite. Okay, so two types of we are going to see the different variations of the loop. The first variation was data type, isn't it? Different types of data types we can use, such as integer, character, boolean, then what else, then floating point. All these types of data types we can use for the control variable. Then next we are going to learn, we have learned infinite loop, okay. Then we are going to learn empty loop, okay. So how to create an empty loop? See, we can give int I equal to 1, okay, I less than or equal to 5. So 5 times this loop will execute, isn't it? Because value of I starting from 1 till 5. See how many times this loop will execute? 5 times, as you know. But if we are adding if we are adding semicolon here, what will happen? So we can compile. So after adding semicolon here, we are getting no syntax error message. So which means this body of the loop will not be considered as the body of the for loop, isn't it? So this statements, this block contains, see, use block we can create using opening brace and closing brace, isn't it? So this block we can create using opening brace and closing brace. There is only one statement, one SOP. So this SOP is currently the part of the for loop, as the body of the for loop, but we have added a semicolon. If you are adding a semicolon here, this block will not consider as the body of the for loop, isn't it? So see, here we can see, so what will happen is this loop will execute, iterate completely. Okay, this loop will iterate completely. It will iterate 5 times. After simply iterating 5 times, it will execute this welcome. Okay, that is going to happen. We can see, so only one time welcome will be printed, but actually for loop is executing, iterating 5 times without executing this body. So after completing the execution of this for loop, this SOP will be executed. So that is the another variation of for loop. I hope you could understand. Then next we are going to learn while loop. So I can write the syntax of while loop here. So as we know, a loop contains many segments: initialization, test condition, body of the loop, update statement. Already we know how to write these all segments in for loop, but now we are going to learn about while loop. So in while loop, initialization will happen first. Initialization, then the while statement, then test condition, then body of the loop, then as the part of the body of the loop, we will write the update statement. Okay, so this is a syntax of while loop. So first initialization, then while statement with the condition, then body of the loop. Update statement will be the part of the body of the loop. So this is how we can write we can use the while loop. So can you guess which kind of loop is while loop? Is it entry controlled or exit controlled? Definitely this one is entry controlled, because in the entry itself it is checking the condition, because before checking the body we are checking the condition. That kind of loop is known as entry controlled loop. Okay, so we can begin with some program 10.18, program using while loop to calculate the sum of the first 100 natural numbers and print their sum. So we need to find out the sum of first 100 natural numbers from 1 to 100. Okay, so the program I have made here. Okay, see, we creating the class, declaring main method, then declaring and initializing a control variable I. Then we need a sum variable in order to store the sum of 1 to 100. Then we are started I with 1, then the condition will be, what will be the condition? Condition will be in the first iteration 1 less than or equal to 100. This condition is true. When this condition becomes false? When the value of I reaches 101. So condition will be like this: 101 less than or equal to 100. Actually 101 is not less than or equal to 100, 101 is greater than 100. So this condition becomes false. This condition will be true till when the value of I reaches 100. This condition will be true. This is the last condition which is true. Okay, So how many times it will iterate? When the value of I reaches 1 to 100, so 100 times this one will be executed. Okay. So we only need to, in each iteration we can add value of I with a variable sum. So what will happen in this line? This line will be sum is equal to sum plus I. Initially value of sum is 0. 0 will be added with 1. That value 1 is copied in the variable sum. In the next iteration, value of i will be 2. Okay. Then go into test condition. 2 less than or equal to 100. Next one, 2 less than or equal to 100, that is also true. So sum is sum plus equal to sum plus I, which means, so now value of sum is 1 and value of I is 2. So 2 plus 1, 3 will be copied in the variable sum. Next time, here 3 plus 3, 9 will be, sorry, 6 will be copied. Like that it will be incremented. So then after executing this while loop many times, means after completing the execution, some variable will have sum of the first 100 natural numbers. So we can check, is it working or not? See, sum of the numbers from 1 to 100 is 5050. Okay. Then next program, 10.19, program to calculate sum of first 50 even and odd integers. So what we want to find out? We want to find out sum of 1 plus 3 plus 5 plus 7 plus till 50. 50 is the is an even number, so till 49. Okay. So sum of this value we need to find out. Also 2 plus 4 plus 6 plus till 50. So these two sum till 50 we need to find out using any loop. Okay. So program 10.9 we are going to see now. 10.19. Okay. Then see, in order we have a control variable I. Then we have two more variables, sum even and sum odd. Sum even will store the sum of first 50 even numbers. Sum odd will store the first sum of first 50 odd numbers. Then the condition is like this: I less than or equal to 50, which means value of i now is 1. This 1 will vary up to 50, isn't it? Because see, I less than or equal to 50. This when the loop wants to stop, value of I should reach 51, then only loop will stop. Just before that, loop will continue. Okay. Then see, what is the meaning of this condition? If I modulus 2 equal to 0, when this condition becomes 0, when the value of I reaches 2, 4 like even numbers, see 2 modulus 2, what will be the remainder? Remainder will be 0. This condition is true. We will add sum even plus equal to I, which means sum even plus value of even number. At this time, when this condition is executing, at this time value of I will be an even number. Otherwise, sum mod plus equal to i will be performed. Okay. Then see I plus plus, it is increasing value of I. At last, after executing this loop completely, sum even and sum mod will have values. So we can check. See, sum of even numbers is 650, sum of odd numbers is 625. Next, program 10.20, Fibonacci series between 1 and 100 using while loop. So that is our program, Fibonacci series. So first of all, you want to understand what is Fibonacci series. Fibonacci series between 1 and 100. Okay. So some Fibonacci series I can write here. So 0 1 1, see, this one is got because we will add the previous two numbers. 0 plus this one will be 1, that one is returned. Then how to find the next number? Add previous two numbers, so this 1 and 1 will be added, that is 2. Okay. Then how to find the next previous sum of previous two numbers? 2 and 1, that will be 3. Then 3 plus 2 will be 5, 5 plus 3 will be 8, 8 plus 5 will be 13, 13 plus 8 will be 21, like that it will go. Okay. Fibonacci series between 1 and 100. So the last number, suppose n is the last number. So this last number will not go after 100 because it in the question it is stating like that. So we can do this program. We can check how. Okay, listen students, here we can just write the Fibonacci series which are 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, then 5, then 8, 13. Okay, this will be continued till the last number less than 100. Okay, last number will not be 100, that will be less than 100. Okay, that because in the question it is given to print Fibonacci series between 1 and 100, that's why. Okay, then see this, for printing the first two we will use an SOP, SOP 0 and SOP 1. Okay, so here we are storing this 0 in the variable F for first, then 1 in the variable S for second. Okay, so instead of printing the 0, we can only print F and S, isn't it? So that is printed here, F and S. You may be thinking why we are giving this space. We have given this space because in order to make space between each digit, that way. Okay, so in the beginning it will declare three variables, F, S and sum. F will assign 0, S will assign 1, sum will be F plus S. 0 plus 1 will be 1, will be in the variable sum. Initially if sum will be 1. Okay, then while sum less than 100 means 1 is less than 100, so this condition is true. So we'll execute body of the loop, it will print sum. So this 2 will be printed, isn't it? Not 2, this 1 will be printed. Now the value of sum is 1, that 1 will be printed, isn't it? So then see, now we have printed these 3. Okay, here you can see using this print function we have printed the first two, 0 and 1, then this condition is true, value of sum is 1, so 1 less than or equal to 100, that condition is true. Then using another print function we are printing value of sum, so because of the print function on the same line it will print value of sum, which is 1. Okay, then our next aim is to print this 2. So for printing this 2 we need to add the previous 2, which means these 2, the sum of these 2 ones are 2, isn't it? The sum of these two values will be the next number, isn't it? Okay, these 2 will be added. So now variable of F has this value and S has this value. So if we add F and S, 0 and 1 will be added and 1 will be the result, but it should add 1 plus 1. So we can copy this 1 to F and S to, sorry, 1 to S, isn't it? So that's why we are copying. Already S has this one, that one going to F, so that's why F equal to S, and this one is now stored in sum, so sum is S is equal to sum. Okay, then now we can find out this 2 by adding the current values of F and S. Current value of F is 1 and current value of S is also 1, these 2. So after adding that 2 values we will get 2 in the variable sum. So what will happen? Statements over. So go into test condition, then sum less than or equal to 100, that is true because 2 is less than 100. So what will happen? The current value of sum will be printed. Okay, what is that? Which is 2. Okay, then we are changing values again, so this one will be copied to F and this 2 will be copied to S. Okay, so this one is copying to F and this 2 is copying to S. Okay, then we will add sum equal to F plus S. So 2 plus 1 will be 3 in the variable sum. Okay, then statements over, go into test condition, 3 less than or equal to 100. So what is happening? Value of sum is 3, that will be printed, so 3 is also printed, isn't it? So this will be continued till when this condition becomes true. Okay, so we can see So we got no syntax error message. Okay, see. So this last number is 89. 89 is the last number because in the program it is specified in the question. That's why. So if we add, if we try to find the next number, that will be sum of 89 and 55, isn't it? What will be the result? It will be 144 will be the next number that is greater than 100. That's why from here, from 89, program has stopped. So I hope you could understand what is Fibonacci. Okay.